say I'm repeating something I've said before. I shall say it again. Shall I say it again? In order to arrive there, to arrive where you are, to get from where you are not, you must go by a way wherein there is no ecstasy. In order to arrive at what you do not know, you must go by a way which is the way of ignorance. In order to possess what you do not possess, you must go by the way of dispossession. In order to arrive at what you are not, you must go through the way in which you are not. And what you do not know is the only thing you know. And what you own is what you do not own. And where you are is where you are not.
To laugh often and much. To win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children. To earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends. To appreciate beauty. To find the best in others. To leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition. To know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded.
My fellow seniors, as we part ways preparing for the gap years and new and home lifestyles, we are experiencing a multitude of changes during the very time in our lives that was thought to be certain. It is easy to look into the past, remembering the classes that had their prom, walked across the circle in late May, and formally parted with the Middlesex community. It is easy to spend sleepless nights wondering when and if these events will occur, thinking about the faces that we may never see again. Oddly enough, though, it's difficult for me to see this warped, alternate reality as strange. So let's play a game. Iconic Middlesex Quotes Roulette. It's a great day to play the game, Ned Herder. In this quote, we understand that Coach Herder is using his fascination of the natural world to bring about optimism in his daily life, specifically with coaching lacrosse. More abstractly, the game could be the game of life itself instead of sports, and playing the game means to simply go with the flow, an attitude that calls you to live in the present no matter what. So what am I getting at here? These words are sitting at the bottom of the AC to remind us Middlesexians that we will remain forever joyful so long as we live in the present. Or kind of. Yes, that seems true to what Coach Herder is saying, but that is simply an interpretation. I was playing the game, yet not as passively as the phrase might suggest. Manipulating with a random quote gave me a message that solves the conflict introduced in the preface of this address. I got what I wanted out of those words. I played the game. So here's what I'm saying. Attitude is everything. As we've all wondered if our yellow is the same as someone else's yellow, all that really matters is that the other guy is smiling because that's his favorite color. Reflecting upon the current times we live in, I've experienced a flurry of emotions we all have gone through as a collective class. Emotions which are completely appropriate given these changes. But perhaps in all this chaos and despair, we have much more control over our lives than it seems. As we mature, we must be responsible for ourselves. And someone who embodies that attitude much too well is a faculty member we all love and chose to speak on behalf of us today. Dr. Monroe is a favorite among Middlesex students, teaching courses for freshmen up to seniors, ranging from West African history to global studies to Harlem Renaissance. Dr. Monroe has high expectations for his students, regardless of age. If you've had a class with him, you'll know that you'll be repeating the beginning of your sentences so long as you depend on the notorious filler words, like, or so. Or that if you're even 10 seconds late to his class, you better have a random fact ready because that'll knock his socks off or it's looking like a rough 40 minutes for you. If you haven't had a class with him, you know that sweatpants don't pass in a Middlesex school day, and maybe, just maybe, you'll catch him one day out of the school year wearing shorts. Hence, Dr. Monroe values reciprocated respect and refined fashion, and he expects his students to strive for the same. Being a dorm faculty once in clay, and more recently BP, and coaching tennis and squash as well, Dr. Monroe takes his passion for helping students grow to the living space and the court. Most can agree that Dr. Monroe has been wholly transformative to the Middlesex community, and that he will be missed, thus making him the student-elected baccalaureate speaker for the class of 2020's graduation. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Monroe.
First and foremost, I want to extend to you, the class of 2020, and your families, a heartfelt congratulations. It's been a year of positive ups and difficult downs. Most importantly, it's been a year that has asked you to come together in support and shared celebration, to witness triumphs, change, and adversity. You all have served as faithful leaders and stewards of the school community, making this academic year one of Middlesex's most dynamic to date. You welcomed a new head of school. You were victorious as ISL and New England champions. You collaborated on art that offered us powerful definitions of identity. You performed in excellent theater productions. You helped to breathe life into new buildings, and you coalesced as the school's most diverse class of students to help build, in my opinion, one of the healthiest and most unified student bodies in Middlesex's history. You have much to be proud of and much to celebrate. As we reflect on these highlights, it's also worth acknowledging the challenges you faced this year, especially in these last 3 months, which, as I'll share, is not as unique to Middlesex students as you might think. Let's travel back a bit. The Spanish flu arrived in the United States on August 27, 1918. By the end of September, 50,000 people in Massachusetts had become afflicted with this disease. In correspondences with his son, Frederick Wahlberg, the namesake of our school's library, hoped, with noted anxiety, that his son had escaped this fast-moving disease that would ultimately kill between 50 and 100 million people worldwide. Because of this, he implored his son to write him more. True to teenager form, and much to his father's chagrin, it doesn't look like young Master Wahlberg heeded his father's wish. Much of the rhetoric around our own pandemic has alluded to the idea that we are in unprecedented times, that we're facing challenges and future uncertainties hitherto not seen, that we're in a unique position. As graduating seniors who have not enjoyed your last few months as a high schooler on campus, and who will, with collective sadness, not physically walk at your graduation on our beautiful campus. It may well feel as though the world has conspired against you, what you've rightfully earned, and what, dare I say, your parents have invested so much in. As much as I, along with my colleagues, as well as your family and friends, lament with great emotion the fact that you've been robbed of such a milestone moment in your young lives, I'd like to offer a caveat that you're not the first group of Middlesex students to miss time on campus due to a pandemic. As I mentioned earlier, the Spanish flu hit hard in late summer 1918. With little time to prepare, and with fewer high-speed communication mediums at his disposal, Frederick Windsor, Middlesex's founder and first head of school, made the prudent decision to postpone the opening of school until October 14th. The football season was canceled. No chance of a New England championship for them, sadly. Living arrangements needed to be reconsidered, and fast. The campus was quarantined. The school would close intermittently throughout the year as the second wave of the flu made itself known. Indeed, one faculty member, a Mr. Galbraith, could not return to campus in the second semester because he was too sick with the Spanish flu. Life, as these students had known it, was now unpredictable, at times scary and isolating. We all feel much the same now, more than 100 years later. At the risk of belaboring the point of asking you all to keep perspective in this current situation, I wanted to make sure that we all take a moment to recognize that, in the same way Middlesex and its students did in 1918, you too will come out of this trying time strong, smart, healthy, and ready to head into a world that is yearning for life and energy and for young people with the skills, principles, and values of a Middlesex graduate. I've had a lot of time to do some big philosophy-type thinking in these past few months. No doubt, many of you have most likely found yourself contemplating some pretty big questions as well. One of the questions I keep coming back to as I ingest all of the uncertainty, suffering, and loss that seems to surround so many of us is, where's the silver lining? This idiom can trace its origins, in all likelihood, to the poet John Milton, who wrote, "Was I deceived, or did a sable cloud turn forth her silver lining on the night?" It's a metaphor for optimism. It challenges us to locate the good in an otherwise bad situation. It does not say that we recognize the good at the expense of the bad, but instead to acknowledge the bad exists, to know that we're heavily affected by the bad, but we can also locate, even at times, only fleeting moments of the good. As we've been trying to figure out the good that can come out of this, I was struck by how much I've thought about the concept of time. Perhaps you can sympathize with me on this. Time has seemed to move both really fast and excruciatingly slow simultaneously. With that recognition, I've come to enjoy each moment more. I've come to savor, if you will, the seconds, minutes, and hours with the people with whom I have been happily forced to live, and with those people with whom I'm now finding more time to reconnect. My COVID-19 silver lining experiences have involved virtually FaceTiming with my 81-year-old mother every day, sharing laughs and food with friends each week on Zoom, teaching my rambunctious 2-year-old daughter how to jump, watching my oldest daughter learn how to draw her favorite book characters from the illustrator himself on his daily YouTube class, and taking time every day to express my gratitude for being a member of this community and being fortunate enough to remain healthy, safe, and with a job. For some of you, locating silver linings at this time might be really hard, and for others, less so. I invite you to not only reflect on what your COVID-19 silver lining experiences have been, but I would encourage you to share those moments of good with others in whatever form suits you. cook a meal for a family member, write a handwritten letter to a friend, help a neighbor, from a safe distance of course, in need, sell masks, donate food or clothing or money, or simply be someone else's silver lining person by being mindfully present, physically or virtually. You're all going to need to process this moment and seek out people with whom you feel comfortable and safe. Be open, available, and empathetic. The world needs an army of silver lining heroes. Don that cape and wear it proudly. I'd like to end with a quote from the June 1919 Anvil. The editors write, "The school year, although unfortunately interrupted at times by illness, has nevertheless been successful and enjoyable. I hope that you too can look back at this year, even these past few months, and find moments of success and enjoyment. I invite you to reflect on that from time to time. You're all so lucky to have received such a wonderful education. You'll realize that as you grow older and your Middlesex experience becomes more distant. You all have seen success and had your moments of enjoyment. Now go into the world, a world that you'll experience in virtual and tangible ways, and look for those silver lining moments. Embrace them, cherish them, and share them. I know I speak on behalf of all of my colleagues in expressing how proud of all of you we are. Congratulations again, Middlesex Class of 2020.